Oh, you believe, give charity for the pleasure of Allah, the pleasure of Allah. Oh, you who believe, read the Quran every night of Ramadan, night of Ramadan. Welcome, O Ramadan, it is Ramadan, it is Ramadan.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, the mercy, and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. Welcome to the show, Ramadan, a date with Dr. Zakir. I'm your host, Yusuf Chambers, and today we will be discussing sighting of the moon. Dr. Zakir, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Dr. Zakir, could you first explain to us how is the beginning of the Islamic month determined?
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain, amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wa halul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. We find that whenever the blessed month of Ramadan approaches, we find a lot of concerns, debates, arguments, and different opinions as far as when does this month begin and end. And we have different people giving their own opinions, etc. But as far as the beginning of the Islamic month is concerned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very clear in the Quran that it is based only and only on the sighting of the moon. The moment you sight the new moon, the Islamic month begins. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 189, they ask thee concerning the new moons, say, these are signs marked, fixed for a period of time for the affairs of men and for pilgrimage. So Allah is very clear that the moment you sight the new moon, the Islamic month begins. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has made it clear in various Sahih Hadith. It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the Book of Fasting, Hadith number 1909, Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, he said, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abul Qasim, that was another name, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that fast when you see the crescent of Ramadan, fast when you see the new moon, that is of Ramadan, and you stop fasting when you see the crescent, that is the new moon of Shawwal. And if the sky is overcast, that means you cannot see the moon, then complete 30 days of Shaban. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very particular to count especially the days in the month of Shaban so that he could be sure when is Ramadan going to begin. And it's mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 2, in the Book of Fasting, Hadith number 2318, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she says that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most careful in counting the days of the month of Shaban. And whenever he saw the new moon of Ramadan, he used to start fasting. And if he could not see the new moon because of cloudy weather, etc., then he used to complete 30 days of Shaban. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi was particular in counting the days of Shaban so that he could know exactly when does the month of Ramadan start. And as far as witness is concerned, whether the moon is sighted or not, the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi said, it's mentioned in Sunan Nisa'i, Book of Fasting, Hadith number 2118, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi said, when two just Muslims sight the moon, when they give shahada, then fast or stop your fast. That means when two just Muslims give their verdict, you can start your fasting, start the month of Ramadan, or stop your fasting in the month of Ramadan. Therefore, two witnesses are required for testifying whether the month of Ramadan has started or ended. But there are other group of scholars who also say the one witness is sufficient to start the month of Ramadan based on the hadith of Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 2, in the Book of Fasting, hadith number 2335, where Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that when people were seeing the moon, trying to find the new moon of Ramadan, I told to the Prophet that I had seen the new moon. The Prophet fasted and he commanded all the people to fast. So based on this one witness alone, most of the scholars, they say that for the beginning of the month of Ramadan, one witness is sufficient. If two, that's preferable, but one is sufficient. And for the end of the month of Ramadan, then two witnesses are required.
Dr. Zakir, you mentioned the issues of witnesses. What kind of a person's testimony will be accepted for sighting of the moon?
As the beloved Prophet Muhammad said, as I mentioned earlier, in Sunan Nisa'i, the Book of Fasting, hadith number 2118, the beloved Prophet said that if two just Muslims, if they sight the moon, then you can start fasting or you can stop fasting. So here the criteria is it should be two just Muslims, that they should be adil. The Arabic word used is adil. It comes from the root word adil, which means straight, which means upright. It's opposite of a crooked person. And adil is a person who does all his obligatory acts, all his farais, and he does not commit any major sins, and he persistently does not commit any minor sins. Completes all his obligatory acts, includes he fasts, he prays, he gives zakat, etc., etc. And does not do any major sins, which we discussed earlier in the previous episode of major sins, does not slander, does not backbite, etc. The person should be of a good character and should have good eyesight. Being adil is a must. The person, besides being adil, the person also should have a good eyesight. Because only if he has a good eyesight can he sight the moon. If he doesn't have a good eyesight, only being adil is not sufficient, because then he may be deluded. So besides being adil, he should also have a good eyesight. And the criteria that's always laid down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, the person should be strong and should be trustworthy. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Qasas, chapter number 28, verse number 26, the criteria for such type of people are that they should be strong and they should be trustworthy. Allah says in Surah Qasas, chapter number 28, verse number 26, speaking about narration of the story of Musa alayhi salam, when one of the two daughters of Shuayb alayhi salam says that he should employ Musa alayhi salam, "Oh my dear father, employ him on your wages," that means hire Musa alayhi salam, "because you truly require a man to employ who is strong and trustworthy." So strength and trustworthiness, these are the two criteria which are required. And a similar message repeated in Surah An-Naml, chapter number 27, verse number 39, when Ifrit, one of the jinns, when he's asked to get the throne of Queen Sheba, then he says that, "Truly indeed, I have got strength, and maybe you can trust me." Means one is the job is entrusted to him. He says he has got strength and you can trust him. So trustworthiness and strength are the two criteria required. So witness should be adil. That he should be trustworthy. That's what's important.
Okay. Thank you for the answer, Dr. Zakir. I'd like to further ask you regarding the sighting of the moon. Is one allowed to use astronomical evidence to sight the moon? After all, isn't that more accurate than using a human witness?
As far as using astronomical evidence, astronomical calculation or computation for the sighting of moon, as far as Islamic month is concerned, and the suggestions have been given very often, it's mainly given by those people who have lack of knowledge of Islam. Because as far as astronomical calculations are concerned, they were there even at the time of the Prophet. And this suggestion was not given only lately. It has even been given at the time of the Prophet. And when we read the hadith, we come to know what the Prophet said about it. It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, in the Book of Fasting, hadith number 1913, where Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that we are an illiterate nation and we do not calculate and we do not do accounts, mainly relating to the month of fasting, indicating that we do not use astronomical calculation or computation as far as calculating the Islamic month is concerned. And he said that it's only so and so, and he did thrice, 1, 2, 3. And third time he pressed his thumb, indicating it's either 29 days or it is, he did thrice like that, so and so, indicating it's 30 days. Now, he said that we don't use astronomical evidence, astronomical calculation or computation. And immediately there's one more hadith, which is mentioned in Sunan Abu Dawud, volume number 2, in the Book of Fasting, hadith number 2313, where Ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, it is said that he fasted alone, along with the people, and did not rely on the astronomical evidence, on the astronomical calculation. From here we come to know that we have to rely only on sighting of the moon with your eyes. That's important. And Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah, he says, when the Prophet ﷺ said that we are an illiterate ummah, what he meant was, he tried to praise us, praise the ummah, saying that we are simple and we don't rely on anything else but the sighting of the moon with our own eyes. It was not a statement used to put the ummah down, but to uplift the ummah, that we follow a simple religion. And Prophet Muhammad ﷺ purposely did not use this competition because he wanted to be followed by the common human being. And he did not want to let this evidence of whether the month starts or not to be in the hands of a selected few people of knowledge. Whether the right or wrong is secondary. So based on that, the astronomical evidence is not used for sighting of the moon. Only seeing with the eyes is sufficient sighting of the moon and to rely whether the Islamic month starts or not. Furthermore, it is the lack of knowledge of Arabic and Islam that people suggest such things. And Ibn Taymiyyah further says that the Arabic word hilal, it actually means to see the moon or to announce. And if the moon is there, but if people don't see it and people don't announce it, then that means the new month hasn't started. Though the moon may be there, but because it's not seen by the people, it's not announced, so it's not started. Furthermore, the Arabic word for month is shahr. It comes from the Arabic word ashar, which means fame. That means unless it becomes famous or it becomes known to the people, the month hasn't started. Many people think that if the moon is there, irrespective whether people cite it or not, whether people know about it or not, whether it becomes famous or not, the month has started. No. It should also be seen by the people and it should be made famous to the people. Then the right Arabic word, shahr, that means known to the people, then can we say the Islamic month has started. So based on this, therefore, the astronomical competition, whether right or wrong, it is not taken into consideration because people should see it themselves. It should be announced and should be made common. Then the Islamic month starts.
I'm sure that that will help a lot of people to understand. Once you've given the derivation of the word, subhanAllah, it makes so much sense. JazakAllah khair. Is it correct to confirm the testimony of a person that claims to have sighted the moon via astronomical evidences or otherwise?
As I mentioned earlier, that using astronomical evidence to know whether Ramadan has started or not is totally wrong. Even to use it as a reconfirmation for the testimony given by the Muslims is totally incorrect. And there are many reasons for this. Point number one, if the astronomical evidence goes against the people who have testified, that means we are doubting those just Muslims. And doubting a just Muslim is against the Quran and the Sunnah. Point number two, if the astronomical evidence goes against the testimony, it may be that some of our acts of worship may be nullified, which will again create a problem. And point number three, which is the most important, it goes against the sayings of the Prophet. Again, it's a commandment of the Prophet. The Prophet said that we are an illiterate nation. We do not use astronomical evidence and computations. So it goes against the Prophet, which is the strongest reason and sufficient for us to stay away from it. Point number four, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number four, verse number 171, لَا تَغْلُوا فِي دِينِكُمْ. Do not commit excesses in your religion. Do not commit excesses. And the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sunan Nisa'i, book of Manasuk al-Hajj, hadith number 3059, the Prophet said, do not exaggerate, because there were people in the past who have been destroyed because of exaggerations, talking about the Jews. Same the Quran also talks about the Jews, that if you exaggerate, then the chance will be destroyed. So what the Prophet said, Allah says, follow it. If you go too much into exaggeration, then you'll be destroyed. And furthermore, the last reason, that people fail to realize that the Prophet said that when you see the moon, then you start fasting. When you see it, then you stop fasting. Based on the hadith which I quoted earlier of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, book of fasting, hadith number 1909. So the main thing is that you should see it. So true fasting begins when you see it with your eyes. Or some Muslims see it with eyes and known to the people. If it's not seen with eyes and if it's not known to the people, then true fasting hasn't begun. So where's the question of astronomical evidence? And furthermore, we find, it's mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Muslim, volume number 2, in the book of fasting, hadith number 2393, that once the Sahaba, who was performing Umrah, and before he reached Makkah, on his way in one of the areas, he saw the moon. And it seemed to be a 2 or 3 day old moon. So when later on he met Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, and told him about this thing that, you know, you're fasting a month of Ramadan now, but already saw that the moon was approximately 2 or 3 days old. So Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, replies that you start fasting when you see the moon. And if the moon is obscured, it's possible the moon wasn't seen. So complete 30 days. So with this, it's sufficient that we don't have to rely on astronomical evidence at all. Seeing it is important and making it known to the people is important. Then the month of Ramadan starts. If it's not seen, if it's not known, it doesn't start.
Okay, once again, you're reaffirming what you've said. I mean, it really is all about us seeing it with our own eyes. But just one last question on instrumentation, if you like. Is one allowed to use a telescope to sight the moon?
As far as using telescope for sighting the moon, it's permissible. Because finally, you have to use your eyes. So a telescope, it only makes it easier for you to see. It brings the object closer to you. It seems to be closer, the object is there. The moon is there, the moon doesn't come closer, but it seems closer and it's easily seen. So using the telescope is permissible. It does not at all go against the Sharia, against the saying of the Prophet. There are some people who do object to it, but they fail to realize that then if they object to using telescope, you'll have to object even seeing with the spectacles. Because when a person sees the spectacle, like when I see, I'm using the spectacles, it's nothing but a glass. It's making a correction in my eyesight and I can see clearly. So if you object using the telescope, that means you have to object even using the spectacles. Telescope is nothing but there are some lenses, some glasses put, so that it helps you in seeing. So as long as you see with your eyes, it helps you in seeing, there's no problem. So the scholars are unanimous in this, that using telescope is permissible if you want to use it. But it will make a little bit difference, not much difference, because when the moon is there, and if it's a cloudy sky, with the telescope also you can't see it. And if you have a good eyesight, without the telescope, if the moon is to be sighted, it will be seen. But if someone wants to use it, he can use it, it's permissible.
No, it makes sense to me. Dr. Zakir, if a person starts fasting in one country, he then travels to a second country, in that country, their month has started 2 days after his country of origin, should he end his fast according to the country that he's traveled to? This would mean, of course, that he would end up fasting 31 or even 32 days. Is this correct for him to do that?
As far as a person who starts fasting in one country, and when he travels to another country, and that country has started maybe 2 days late, and if he continues and he ends his month of Ramadan, according to the second country where he has traveled, it may be that he may end up fasting 31 days or 32 days. So should he fast till the end of that country, or should he continue with the country of origin, and when they finish the Ramadan, they should finish? As far as this question is concerned, as Allah's Prophet has clearly mentioned in the hadith of Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, Book of Fasting, hadith number 1907 and 1909, that a Prophet said that when you see the new moon, you start fasting, and when you see the new moon, you stop fasting. So based on this, but natural, and another hadith of Tirmidhi, Book of Fasting, hadith number 697, the beloved Prophet said, the fast is the day you all fast. And the breaking of the fast is the day when you all break the fast. And the day of sacrifice is the day when you all sacrifice, indicating it should be done in congregation, it should be in Jama'ah. It can't be done individually. So because the person, when he shifts from one country to another country, he should follow the rules and regulations as the people of that country where he's staying in. So if he stays in a country where they start fasting early, he should start fasting early with them. And if he goes to a country where the fasting is delayed, the month of Ramadan is delayed by 2 days, he should continue with them. Even if he has to fast 1 or 2 days more, he has to continue doing that. Because he has to be with the Jama'ah. He has to be with the people. It cannot be that the other people are fasting and he's not fasting. He should maintain the Jama'ah. That as what the people are doing in the country where he's living, he should continue doing that. Even if he has to fast 1 or 2 days more. I know the month of Ramadan either has 29 days or 30 days, but since he has to follow the hadith, that the fast is the day when all the people fast. And the breaking of the fast is the day when all the people break the fast. So he should continue and break the fast only when all the people break, even if he has to fast 1 or 2 days more. And similarly, if a person, when he starts fasting, and if he travels to another country, and maybe the sunset is about 2 hours late, so he has to fast 2 hours more. He can't say the country of origin, the sun was setting at 6 o'clock, and here it is setting at 8 o'clock, so I will fast 2 hours less. No. So the same way, as far as setting of the moon is concerned, he has to do extra days. If it's the vice versa, if a person starts fasting, if a person starts the month of Ramadan in a country and then goes to a country which has already started the month of Ramadan 2 days earlier than the country of origin, or 1 day earlier than the country of origin, in this case also, he has to continue fasting with the people of that area, even though he may have to fast 1 day less. Maybe he'll have to fast only 28 days. But in this case, since a month cannot be 28 days, he has to celebrate Eid with the people of that country. But later on, he should compensate for the fast he has missed, because the month of Ramadan cannot have 28 days. So if both the countries where he started and ended, both have got 30 days, and if he fasted for 28 days, then he has to compensate 2 days. But if the country of origin had 29 days, or the country of to which he has traveled has 29 days, then he has the option of only fasting for 29 days. Then he has to make up only one fast. But he has to complete at least 29 or 30 days, depending upon the country of origin and destination.
And maybe if you want to get more reward, you have to travel east. Dr. Zakir, perhaps you could shed some light on the issue of why it is that the Muslims of the world are not united as regards to the fasting and the celebration of Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha.
As far as Muslims throughout the world be united in starting the month of Ramadan, ending the month of Ramadan, and celebrating Eid, there are scholars which are divided. There is one group of scholars who say that throughout the world you should follow the timing of Makkah. So if Makkah starts the month of Ramadan, everyone throughout the world should follow Ramadan. If Makkah ends Ramadan, then everyone throughout the world should end Ramadan. And if Makkah celebrates Eid, then everyone else in the world should celebrate Eid. And this is the view even of Sheikh bin Baz. When a person asked him that he was a Saudi who traveled to Spain, and he said that I have been fasting according to the calendar of Makkah. And in Makkah, if they started fasting, I started fasting in Spain according to Makkah and ended fasting according to Makkah and celebrated Eid according to Makkah. Is it right? And Sheikh bin Baz said, there's no problem. It is right, because Makkah is a holy city. But the other group of scholars, they disagree and they say that the timings should be according to the area. There should be time zones. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 185, that if you sight the moon, so those who sight the moon, those who witness the moon, or those who are present at home, in the month, they should fast. And our beloved Prophet ﷺ also said, mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3 in the book of fasting, hadith number 1907 and 1909, the Prophet said that when you see the new moon of Ramadan, then you start your fast, and when you see the new moon of Shawwal, then you end the fast. So based on this, the people of that area should see the moon. And if that area is common, it may be one city, it may be a full country, or a couple of countries together, that is right ruling. And Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah says that you cannot have that all together. You cannot have all the Muslims in the world fasting together. And he also says that even according to scientific evidence, even according to astronomical evidence, it's not possible that all the Muslims throughout the world can fast on one day. Because the moon cannot be sighted all together on one day. There has to be difference. So it's illogical to say that we should fast altogether. And the beloved Prophet Muhammad ﷺ said, it's mentioned in Tirmidhi, Book of Fasting, Hadith number 697, that the fast is when you all fast. And the breaking of fast is when you all break the fast. And the day of sacrifice is when all the people sacrifice. So as long as people of that area, they fast, it is sufficient, that is fasting. And when people of that area, that locality, that city or country, if they break the fast, then break the fast. Because as we see that there is no difference of opinion as far as the timings of sun is concerned. As far as starting of the each day, as far as when the day starts and the day ends, there's no difference of opinion. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 187. It says that eat and drink until the white thread of dawn is distinguished from the black thread, and fast till the night falls, until the sun sets. So here, in each part of the world, the sun sets earlier. That does not mean because in Malaysia the sun sets earlier, in Bombay I will end my fast earlier. So that means the people in Makkah also should end it early. And if in the Western world the sun sets a bit late, I'll also end my fast late. The unanimous agreement throughout the world that you have to follow the timing of the sun according to your local timing. If the sun sets in your area, then you stop fasting and you can eat. If the dawn breaks in your area, then you stop eating and you start fasting. There's no different opinion. So as we follow the sun, we should even follow the moon the same way. Imagine if we celebrate Eid, if the new moon of Shawwal is sighted in Makkah, and we celebrate Eid, maybe in America, in the West, the moon may have been sighted one day earlier. That means they have to celebrate Eid one day later. And in Pakistan or India, the new moon will be sighted 1 or 2 days later. So does it mean that they have to celebrate Eid in the month of Ramadan? And imagine those people, if they are for Makkah timing, they'll have to fast even on the day of Eid. In America, where the moon may be seen Monday earlier, that means they will have to fast on the day of Eid, which is haram. Prophet said you cannot fast on the day of Eid. So here we realize that we have to follow the same rule as we follow for the timings of the sun. Otherwise, there'll be a big chaos and it will not be practically possible. And many people who say that, you know, how is it possible that, you know, Muslims in different parts of the world have Eid on different days? It's normal. We are used to having different timings in the sun. The morning time, when it's daytime in India, it is nighttime in America. We don't say, oh, how is it nighttime there and daytime here? When it's nighttime here, daytime there. We don't say, oh, what a stupid thing that people are united. Because that is the way it is. The timings of the sun differ. And the timings of the sun in the full world, it differs by 24 hours. 0 minute to 24 hours. It depends upon which longitude is your area. If it is the same longitude, then the timing would be same. And the world is divided with 360 degrees, 360 longitudes. Each longitude, it differs by 4 minutes. So if you travel by 15 longitudes, then there'll be a difference of 1 hour. So 360 multiplied by 4 comes to 1,440 minutes. That's equal to one full day. So the world is divided into time zones. Now, just for the betterment, for ease, what we do, that though India has got more than 15 degrees longitude, yet the time is common. They take a center point and they say whether it's Bombay or Gujarat, one end of India, or whether it's Assam, the other end of India, the breadth, yet they follow the same timing. They take the central time. But in countries like USA, the width is much more. It is more than 30 degrees. The timing may differ more than 2 hours, but they have approximately 4 time zones. The time in Los Angeles is 2 hours earlier than the time in New York. So it differs. So there it will be, imagine, person phones from New York to Los Angeles, and he wonders that they're there 2 hours earlier, but this is how the time zones are divided, and people are living with it. The same way people fail to realize that as far as scientific evidence for moon is concerned, the new moon can differ by 1 or 2 days. It is scientific. It's not possible that the new moon can occur throughout the world on the same day. It's not possible. It is unscientific. And I had just spoken to a scientist who was specialized in the field of astronomy. Just London had been there. And he told me that 1 or 2 days is common. Sometimes there can even be a difference of 3 days. Sighting the moon in one part of the world to the other part of the world, it can be a difference even of 3 days. And once in a blue moon, it can even go up to 4 days. It may happen, I don't know, once in 1,000 years. I don't know. He gave some calculation, which I understand. But normally, differing by 1 or 2 days is common. It is scientific. The new moon cannot be sighted on the same day throughout the world. How the sun cannot rise on the same day throughout the world. So here people fail to realize that celebrating same day throughout the world will be unscientific and it will be un-Islamic also. Because when you have to have 2 witnesses to sight, only when 2 witnesses sight, as the beloved Prophet said, can the people of that area celebrate. What we can have for convenience, people in a few cities then have one area of sighting the moon, or one full country can have one common area of sighting the moon, or a couple of countries, if they're close and fall in the same area, they can have. But throughout the world, it's not possible, and it is not even scientific. So I agree with Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah and Sheikh Uthaymeen when they say that it's not possible to have sighting of the moon throughout the world on the same day.
Okay. Jazakallah khair. So from your answer, Dr. Zakir, it's clear that there can be some differences from country to country in regarding the sighting of the moon, following of the Eid, and starting and the end of Ramadan, alhamdulillah. What's the ruling regarding people in the same city differing regarding Eid and Ramadan, etc.?
As far as people differing in the same city, the beloved Prophet ﷺ was very clear. It's clearly mentioned in the Hadith of Tirmidhi, in the Book of Fasting, Hadith number 697, the Prophet, peace be upon him, said, the fast is the day when you all fast, mean the whole Muslim community fast. And the break of fast is the day when you break the fast. And the day of sacrifice is the day you sacrifice, mean all of you sacrifice, indicating that it should be in congregation. People of the same city cannot differ because the city is not that big where the sighting of moon will differ. So the area of sighting of the moon has to cover at least one city. I don't know of any city in the world which is so big that covers, a very large area. There can be occasions when few cities can be clubbed together and they can have the same area of sighting of moon. Or the full country can, as I mentioned earlier, can have the same sighting of moon. Or there can be a few countries close to each other, may have the same sighting of moon. But as far as the city is concerned, they should have the same sighting of moon. A person cannot differ. Like in the same city, one person starting Ramadan today, other person starting tomorrow, it's not permissible. All have to start Ramadan together, end Ramadan together, and celebrate Eid together.
Jazakallah khair. It's very logical and straightforward. It's not rocket science. Dr. Zakir, there are many non-Muslims, no doubt, and I have met some of them, who are confused and they often ask themselves, what sort of a religion is this in which people of the same city, are not united upon this wonderful day, this celebration of Eid, and also the beginning and the ending of Ramadan. I would really appreciate it if you could comment on that.
I do agree with you that many a time we Muslims make a laughing stock of ourselves, that they wonder what sort of religion is this Islam where people are united in the same city. You have 2 different days of Eid. Sometimes you have 3 days, 3 different days of Eid. today, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, 3 different days of Eid. So they wonder, what sort of religion is this? And for this, as I explained to you in the earlier two answers, Islam is very clear. There's an unanimous decision. But we Muslims are to blame. It is not Islam. We Muslims are to blame because the Prophet Muhammad was very clear that we should be united. The Quran is very clear. It is we Muslims who are to blame that we are divided. The problem is not an Islam problem, is in us Muslims. The problem is that we have many Hilal committees. Many. One city has 3-4 Hilal committees. Or many a time, there is one Hilal committee, but there are subdivisions, you know, each belonging to one group. So the problem is in us Muslims. We have many Hilal committees, each belonging to one group, one sect, each fighting among themselves, or one Hilal committee having subdivisions. So what happens? That there's ego problem between them. And that happens in many parts of the world, whether it be USA, whether it be UK, whether it be Pakistan, whether it be India. And in Bombay, it has happened several times that Eid is celebrated on 2 different days, sometimes even 3 different days. And what happens? That they have ego problem. That if the witness of group or Hilal Committee A is there, and Hilal Committee B gets angry, or maybe they want that we should announce first, and if Hilal Committee A announces first, B out of the way will differ to prove that we are stronger, and they want to show who has a bigger following. So this is a big fitna. And because of their own ego, the problem we have in Muslim Ummah is that we Muslims, we are being troubled and we are not able to follow our deen because of these groups. So the main problem is the Hilal committees because of the ego problem between themselves. And it has happened several times in several parts of the world that they purposely differ. If Group A announces, Group B will go out of the way to differ. So, you know, what we should have, we should get together. And no problem. For the betterment of the Ummah, we should let our ego go down. And we should come together on a common platform. And whoever has more ego, let him lead, no problem. As long as we unitedly celebrate the Eid. As the Prophet said, you fast when all the people fast. You break the fast when all the people break the fast. You celebrate Eid, then all the people celebrate Eid. So if you let the ego be reduced and let us come together and see to celebrate the Eid together, then this problem, otherwise this problem will never be solved. And previously there used to be 2 different dates. Now 3rd date has cropped up because of these people following Saudi, which I discussed in my earlier answers. That, you know, now they say that, okay, we will follow the time of Saudi Arabia. That's another problem. And that has cropped up recently. It has become more. And we find that in Canada, in UK, in USA, there are 3 days of Eid. The infighting amongst the local Hilal committee is one problem. And some people are saying we'll follow Saudi Arabia. That's another problem. So they have further increased the problem. So we Muslims should be, as Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse number 3, وَاتَصِيمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمْعَ وَلَا تَفَرَقُّ. Hold the rope of Allah strongly and be not divided. The rope of Allah is the glorious Quran and the Sahih Hadith. So we should hold to it strongly and be not divided.
SubhanAllah, what we need to do is bring back the logic of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he was placing the black stone, remember the story? If we could have that back, that's it. It would be great.
And we see this problem is very little in the Gulf countries. In Saudi Arabia, there's only one committee where whatever they say, everyone follows. And fortunately, even the countries around them, whether it be UAE, whether it be Bahrain, they follow Saudi Arabia because they fall in the same area. It's not that big countries. So there's no problem and we are not laughing stock. They celebrate Eid on one day. When they announce, everyone follows. It's Eid. When they say Ramadan, everyone follows. So they are the best example, the Gulf countries. We Muslims in the non-Muslim countries, we have a problem. We try to show off an ego, etc. Try to differ, that's the problem. So we should follow the example of the Gulf countries. Alhamdulillah, they're united. And they have won at least as far as the sighting of the moon is concerned.
Inshallah, it should improve the more educated our youth get and
inshallah.
Start
inshallah.
Taking over the place, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Well, Doctor, I'm afraid that's all we've got time for regarding the interview section. Now we're going to move on to the question and answers on the topic of sighting of the moon. Right, well, the first question we have from one of our respected viewers is, why do Muslims follow the lunar calendar instead of the solar calendar?
There are various reasons why we follow lunar calendar. And following lunar calendar is much more beneficial as compared to solar calendar. Because as Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse 189, that when they ask thee concerning new moons, say that they are signs for marking the fixed period of time as far as the affairs of men are concerned and pilgrimage. So in lunar calendar, what we have that every year, the time and the climate, if we follow the solar calendar, for example, Ramadan or Hajj, will come in the same season. It will come in the same month of the solar calendar, but the season would be the same, it would not change. But if we follow the lunar calendar, if the lunar month is the same, it keeps on changing the climate. So because the difference between the lunar and the solar calendar is 11 days, approximately. The lunar calendar is 11 days less than the solar calendar. So if we follow the solar calendar, if suppose Ramadan comes in a country in winter, throughout his life, Ramadan will come in winter. If in one part of the world, Ramadan is in summer, throughout the world it will be in summer. So it will be a disadvantage. Someone will compare to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why am I living in a country where Ramadan is always in summer? Or someone will say, oh, it's good, Ramadan is always in winter. Some people will fast the full Ramadan, the full life, always having long days. Some people have short days. So when we follow the lunar calendar, in approximately 33 years of your life, we have Ramadan coming in all the seasons of the year. Sometimes it will be in summer, sometimes in winter, sometimes in autumn. Sometimes the days will be short, sometimes the days will be long, or it will be average throughout your life. So this is, alhamdulillah, scientific. So to follow the lunar calendar is beneficial. We have Hajj in all the seasons, we have Ramadan in all the seasons, we have Eid in all the seasons. So no one can complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they have taste of all the seasons to follow Ramadan and to keep the fast, and as well as to celebrate Eid. So it's more scientific to follow the lunar calendar as compared to following the solar calendar.
Jazakallah, Dr. Zakir. Next question. Is it permissible for Muslims who are living in a non-Islamic country to form a committee to confirm the sighting of the new moon for Ramadan, Shawwal and Dhul Hijjah?
As far as forming a Hilal committee, a committee for sighting the moon in a non-Muslim country, it's not permissible. It is in fact preferable, or it may become compulsory that there should be, if there are many Muslims living in that country, so that Muslims are united. It is mustahab, it's preferable that they should form a Hilal committee so that the Muslims of that area, whether living in USA or living in UK or in India, they have common point of reference. But as I mentioned earlier, the Hilal committee should be united. They should not be fragmented. There should be one Hilal committee. There should not be many Hilal committees. Otherwise, we'll have Eid on separate days, as I discussed earlier. There should be but one common committee following Quran and Sunnah.
Jazakallah khair for the short answer. Next question, and unfortunately today, last question. Can the testimony of a woman be accepted with regards to sighting of the moon for Ramadan?
As far as accepting the testimony of a woman for sighting of a moon is concerned, there are different opinions. According to the Hanafis, or Hanafi school of thought, if it's a cloudy day, then the testimony of a woman can be accepted. The testimony of women can also be accepted by the Hanbalis, and one group of Shafis also accept the testimony. Whereas the other group of Shafis, they say that testimony of the woman cannot be accepted, and the Malikis are unanimous that testimony of women cannot be accepted. So there are two groups of scholars. One group says that it can be accepted, one they say it cannot be accepted. And Sheikh Utaimi, may Allah have mercy on him, he says that the testimony of women cannot be accepted. And he gives reasons for that. He says that because the Quran says that there should be two just witnesses. And the Arabic word used in the hadith of Tirmidhi, Book of Fasting, hadith number 2118, it says shahidain. So he says the woman is a shahida, not a shahid. So based on that argument, he says that woman testimony cannot be accepted. The other group of scholars, they said can be accepted. And as far as the Arabic word is concerned, that many a time when the male word is used, the even woman is included. So to just pick on the word and say that, so the other group of scholars say that it's not right to pick on the word and say because it's shahidain, a woman cannot be accepted. And furthermore, they say, the group which say that woman testimony can be accepted, they say that when we ask a woman that which is the direction of Qibla, and the woman shows the direction, but naturally we follow it, and we can ask the timings of Salah to a woman if you go to a foreign land, that what is the timing of Salah, and she tells the timing, it's accepted. So when we accept this, why can't we accept the sighting of the moon? That's what they argue. And further they argue that many of the hadith have been narrated only by one narrator, the chain of narration. And Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, the wife of the Prophet, she alone has narrated no less than 2,220 hadith. So in her alone, witness is accepted. Even this hadith of the sighting of the moon is hadith of Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased. So when you can accept her narration alone, so why can't we accept the shahada of the moon? So this argument is very strong, you know, that when we can accept that Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased, when she narrated the hadith of sighting of the moon, and we accept the hadith, so why can't we accept when she says that she has seen the moon? So the group which says that woman's testimony can be accepted is much more acceptable, though there is a difference of opinion in this aspect.
Well, Jazakallah khair for your excellent answers today, Dr. Zakir Naik. And I think it's a very controversial issue amongst many Muslims, and I pray and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us lessen the difficulties and the differences between us, so we can all celebrate Eid in each city. We can all celebrate Eid together, and we won't be the laughing stock of any non-Muslims or such like, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Brothers and sisters, do join us again tomorrow at the same time, when we'll be discussing the topic Zakat al-Fitr. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
صدق يومنا صبر ورفق بدموع البائسين
رمضان قد أهل بالصيام وأطلى مسعدا أهلا وخلا لتهون